Penguin Random House Audio presents Life as No One Knows It, The Physics of Life's Emergence. This is the author, Sara Imari Walker. To my lineage, with the hope we may one day come to understand what we are. 1. What is life? Have you ever wondered what makes you alive? What makes anything alive? At the 2012 meeting of the American Chemical Society, in a session on the origin of life, Andrew Ellington proposed a radical theory: life does not exist. Andy is a chemistry professor from the University of Texas at Austin, and this was the first slide of his presentation on RNA chemistry and the origin of life. His idea left me incredibly perplexed. RNA is an acronym for ribonucleic acid, an important biomolecule believed by some to play a critical role in the origin of life due to its function as an information-bearing molecule and a chemical catalyst. I was perplexed because I probably should have agreed with Andy, but I don't. When I attended Andy's lecture, I was pretty sure I was alive, as I am now. You're probably confident you are alive too. Haven't you spent your whole life, well, living? Being alive matters. It's very different from not being alive. Yet despite our natural confidence in our own existence, some scientists challenge it and argue that life may be just an illusion or an epiphenomena explainable by known physics and chemistry. Physicist and public intellectual Sean Carroll is one such individual. In a crowded evening lecture on the Arizona State University campus where I work, I was aghast in my seat as Sean stated how the equations of particle physics are sufficient to explain the existence of all matter, including you and me. Jack Szostak, a Nobel Prize winner, holds a similar view, arguing that the focus on defining life is holding us back from understanding life's origin. According to Jack, the closer you look at any of the defining properties of life, the more the boundary between life and non-life blurs. As a child, I remember trying to take an insect apart and then failing to restore it to its original state. I was too surprised at the time to even feel upset. We are all familiar with how life cannot be reduced to its parts, be they elementary particles, atoms, or even molecules. Perhaps it is easiest to take the view, as Andy, Jack, and Sean do, that life is not a property of its parts, and that therefore we don't need to worry about defining it. If true, it follows that all we need to understand what life does and how it emerges is to understand those parts. In my training as a theoretical physicist, I was taught to believe that life was not a conceptually deep scientific problem. Instead, the most fundamental concepts regarding the nature of reality were what other physicists had studied, things like space, time, light, energy, and matter. Indeed, the successes of physics have been nothing short of profound. Over the short span of the last 400 years, we have gained a deep understanding of how our universe works. We have even defined what we mean by universe. At the very small scales, we understand much about the elementary constituents of all matter. At the very largest scales, we can take photos of distant galaxies whose light took more than 13.5 billion years to reach our telescopes. Yet the origin of life remains one of the greatest puzzles in science. Physics, as we collectively understand it at this moment in history, provides a fundamental description of a universe devoid of life. It's not the universe I live in, and I bet you don't live there either. But if life does exist, what is it? What are we? If vitalism is dead, maybe you are too. In stark contrast to the views of modern physicists and chemists, scientists used to believe life exists as a separate category from matter. Animated matter was believed to be imbued with a vital force, something referred to as the élan vital. Aristotle called it entelechy. Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz called it monads. They were both describing, as many have, a unique quality found only in living entities that directs living behaviors, such as the development of an embryo, regeneration of a lost limb, or any of the other purposeful activities that seem uniquely characteristic of life. This concept of being alive is somewhat akin to the religious concept of a soul, and some have even called it that. Whatever you call it, we think these features are unique to life because we do not observe them in non-living things. A rock does not restore its original shape when cut in two, but a planaria worm can and does. Vitalism, as the scientific movement came to be called, was driven by the idea that what makes matter come alive cannot be described mechanically and is therefore not material. While modern materialists like Andy, Sean, and Jack regard the known properties of matter as sufficient for explaining life, the vitalists had quite the opposite view. They believed that life does, in fact, exist, but it cannot be explained in terms of the properties of matter. Often, the idea of a vital principle was discussed in terms of a life energy or a vital spark that could animate even dead matter. If this sounds a bit Frankensteinian, that's because it is. Mary Shelley was just 21 when her famous novel Frankenstein was published in 1818. When she penned the book, she was reflecting on the leading science of her day, particularly theories on the soul, what makes us alive, and how we might reanimate the dead with electricity. Mary was influenced by the contemporary work of Luigi Galvani, work later carried on by his nephew, Giovanni Aldini. These two attempted to animate body parts through electrostimulation. They would stimulate dead frogs' legs with electric shocks to make them dance. Mary was also reportedly inspired by Erasmus Darwin, grandfather of the more famous Darwin, Charles. The elder Darwin wrote on the topic of spontaneous generation, citing how inanimate materials could spontaneously become animated in water warmed by sunlight. In Mary's novel, the body parts of the recently deceased could be reanimated by electrocution if they were properly wired together. This is how her lead character, Dr. Victor Frankenstein, made his living monster from dead bodies. If we were to try to write down laws of physics that could explain Dr. Frankenstein's unique insight in animating the monster, we might conjecture he had discovered a life force that dissipated slowly after death, and that whatever substance this force was made of was strongly coupled to electromagnetism. It's a bit of an odd set of properties Dr. Frankenstein discovered in his fictional universe, but matter in our real universe has many strange properties too. Our universe is weird when you start to understand it. In fact, it gets odder the more you think you understand it. We might imagine a consistent physics that Dr. Frankenstein tapped into that explains life. It just so happens that whatever physics he was onto is not the physics that describes our real universe. The real physics underlying life might be even stranger still. While right now we do not understand what principles govern life, they may one day be as obvious to subsequent generations as the curvature of space-time or the existence of particles of light, photons, are to us now. Many of the vitalists thought life could not be produced by things that were not already themselves alive. Living matter was special because its parts were special, carrying some of that requisite élan vital. Thus, living things were necessary to make more living things. Even Dr. Frankenstein had to make his monster from once living parts that were only recently deceased. Around the time of the publication of Frankenstein, the idea that life is necessary to produce the stuff of life was already beginning to lose popular support within the scientific community. In 1828, Friedrich Wöhler synthesized urea, an organic molecule found in urine, from two other simple molecules, cyanic acid and ammonium. Friedrich's experiment showed that biologically derived molecules do not carry any sort of life force. The component parts of living matter are no different from those of non-living matter. In experiments like these, scientists have repeatedly demonstrated that there is nothing that separates the properties of non-living chemistry from living chemistry. The former can easily be transformed to the latter under appropriate conditions. The sharp boundary between non-life and life started to blur as humanity began to understand more about chemistry and the physics underlying it. Sean, Jack, Andy, and many others who hold similar views are right, to a degree. In fact, as much as we have looked, we have found the transformation from a non-living to a living substance is not excluded by any known law of physics or chemistry. There is no life conservation law that says life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.